Our panelists are from two of the industries hardest hit by this pandemic, restaurants and retail. Jide Zeitlin is the chairman and CEO of Tapestry, which is the parent company of Coach, Kate Spade, and Stuart Weitzman. Michelle Gass is the CEO of Kohl's, which operates more than 1,100 stores in 49 states, along with its e-commerce platform, Kohl's.com. And Jean Lee is the president and CEO of Darden, which owns and operates more than 1,700 restaurants across North America, including Olive Garden and Longhorn Steakhouse. I'm going to start, Jide, with you. And I want to start, before we turn to the impact of the pandemic, I want to start with you because you wrote a very powerful letter to your employees amid the protests and after a number of your stores were damaged. You wrote, and I quote, "We can replace our windows and handbags, but we cannot bring back George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, Eric Garner, Trayvon Martin, Emmett Till, and too many others. Each of these Black lives matter." Can you talk about your perspective on these last couple of weeks and the message you wanted to communicate to your employees through this letter?
It was an interesting moment, clearly. This has been an unbelievable moment for our country and more broadly. And I found myself a little bit over a week ago in an environment where a lot of corporations were starting to come out with statements about what was going on in the streets of this country, and was trying to think about what did I want to say. And it was clear as I looked at what a number of other corporations were saying that everyone was trying to walk a very tight line between expressing empathy while at the same time not stepping out of the lane from a corporate perspective. And I thought that this was actually a moment where one needed to speak as authentically as I could to, you know, our 25,000 broad employees around the world, not just here in the United States, both because it was this odd moment that was sad, clearly, in terms of the events that were going on, but one that also I believed was optimistic. And particularly with the passage of time, and one has seen the support more broadly for the protesters, and really what it was and what it is that has taken the protesters out on the street, I thought that it made sense to send a message on a few fronts. First, you know, to our employees, I wanted them to understand that this was a moment to be human. To be authentic and to be vulnerable, which is something that we don't always do when we think about how we show up at work as opposed to be at home, as opposed to when we're at home, even though many of us clearly are working remotely from home. And I wanted to send them a message that this was a time to have conversations that otherwise might not feel comfortable having, just because it was very clear that everybody, at least most, the vast majority of people in our organization, I suspect across many organizations, were trying to process what was going on. And the best way to do that was to talk. So I believe that the best way to do that was to model it, you know, from the top, was to be human, was to be vulnerable, and was to share what I was thinking and how my life experience had brought me to that thought process, but also how I thought that there were some real universal issues and feelings that would hopefully bring out a broader conversation amongst employees and their families and their communities in a way that would ultimately make us as a corporation, but most importantly, make us as a country stronger for it.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And, you know, the comments about authenticity, listening, being vulnerable, those are things, as I've talked to our employees over the last 10 days, have really resonated with me. I want to, Michelle and Jean, I want to get your perspectives on this too. So many of your businesses and small business owners joining us today are an integral part of their communities. And as businesses are beginning to reopen, communities across the country are facing very important questions around racial justice. How are you thinking about these difficult issues for your employees and more broadly during this very, very challenging time? And Michelle, I'll start with you.
Thanks, David, and I appreciate the opportunity to be with you all this evening. I think what Jide said is so true. It's showing up, it's being vulnerable, it's being authentic, and it's allowing for the conversation to happen. I mean, this is a long-standing systemic issue, and the events of the last few weeks are certainly providing a catalyst for great change. And we have the responsibility, especially in roles like ourselves, to help drive and foster that change. So I think similar to the comments earlier, for me, it was important for me to communicate right away to all of our associates. We employ about 100,000 associates around the country. And since the crisis began mid-March, I began a practice of doing a video started live. We ended up taping due to some technical challenges, but every Monday they could expect to hear from me on how at the time the COVID crisis was unfolding. And then when this happened 2 weeks ago, we obviously quickly pivoted the message and it became all about the social issues that we were facing. And we don't have all the answers by any stretch, but I wanted to make sure that our associates felt like we were a place that certainly respects and embraces diversity in every sense, that we support all the opportunities ahead. And diversity inclusion has been a key value for the company for some time, but I'm going to take this opportunity to say we're not doing enough and we're going to do more. I mean, our purpose statement at the company is all around families, to inspire and empower families to lead more fulfilled lives. And for us, it's about all families. Even as a matter of fact, this week, I'm headed to Minneapolis on Thursday, and we're doing lots of We're Listening sessions with our African-American associates. And like I said, we by no means have all the answers or solutions, but I think it starts with being vulnerable, being authentic, and listening. And so that's the first stage for us.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you for those comments. You know, Gene, I want to turn to you and just get some of your perspectives on this.
No, thank you, David, and thanks for having me tonight. You know, I want to echo everything that Jide and Michelle have said. I think, you know, one thing I'm thinking about now is the message goes out from the CEO, and it's a moment in time. And the team members look at that, and I'm really starting to think about, okay, what's next? And how do we, across this large, diverse workforce of 180,000 people, can we ensure our leadership at the front line is providing the right environments for them, for everybody? So how do we make sure our people know what programs and what kind of help we have for them, especially through our employee assistance program? I think that's a big opportunity. But more importantly, how do we access the tools that we've developed over time to help teach people about diversity and inclusion? And so this is more than just one letter from the CEO. And we really focus on what's happening in 1,800 different restaurants. And more importantly, each one of those restaurants has a unique workforce, and not all answers or solutions help each workplace. We have to be able to adapt to individual environments across the whole country.
So thank you for that. Jide, I saw in a recent interview you brought up, a recent interview I watched that you gave, you brought up the importance of diversity and bringing diverse voices to the table. How do you think and hope that the recent events will help guide companies, both large and small businesses, across the country as they think about diversity?
So my sense is, David, probably two ways. First, clearly focusing everybody on what's their population look like? How diverse is it? And what actions can they be taking to increase the diversity of their population? And not just at entry levels, but all the way through the organization. I think that's important. But the key, I believe, is ultimately as much about culture as it is about your diverse statistics. So if at the end of the day, you have a very diverse organization, but your culture is still one that is still kind of rooted a few decades ago, it makes it very difficult to really both be as effective as a corporation as possible, but also for your employees to be as engaged and to give as much as possible to the organization. And I think where a lot of companies and other organizations do trip up is they focus with a lot of intensity on the statistics, but not on the culture, not on effectively finding ways to allow employees to really show up as they are. We all spend so much time at work. You know, arguably, we spend more waking hours at work and with colleagues at work than we do with our families. Yet, if we don't feel as though we can show up as ourselves, there's a lot that gets left behind in terms of our ability to have an impact in the company, and as such for the company to have an impact in what it does and how it engages with its customers, with how it solves problems more broadly. So it's really that second part, culture or inclusivity, that, that I focus the most on.
Gene, I want to shift and talk a little bit about the restaurant industry for a moment. You've been in the restaurant industry for 30 years, and I have to imagine the last few months have had to be about as challenging as it gets in the restaurant industry. As you think about these recent events and the broad impact of the pandemic, what would you say you've learned about the industry's ability to adapt and evolve, and how could that be helpful to the restaurant owners in the audience? Because I know there are a bunch of people in restaurant food service in our audience of small businesses here.
Yes, there are a couple of things come to mind. First of all, what I learned first and foremost was restaurant leaders and team members are incredibly flexible and creative. I watched our teams implement an off-premise operational process in under a week to meet the demand for of the consumer as we transitioned from closing our dining rooms to an off-premise business only. That was absolutely amazing. The second thing that I learned was that brands matter and customer loyalty really matters. And it was to watch our guests come in and make sure our team members were being taken care of during this time when they were out of work. We actually had guests coming into restaurants and dropping off large sums of money to ensure that the team members were getting paid. And I found that to be really fascinating. The last thing I think that's really important for the restaurant owners, and I think anybody in business, the one takeaway I'm getting from this crisis is people matter. We're in the restaurant business, we're a people business. We serve food, we do it in atmospheres, but we're really all about people. And we worked hard to stay connected with our people through the crisis, and it's enabled us to bring our people back to work quickly, get them excited about what we're doing. And we're able to ramp up our businesses a lot quicker than others because of that connectivity. And so I think the big takeaway for in the restaurant business, people matter. You're in a people business and people are going to define your success.
Michelle, when it comes to retail space, you've spent decades, you have decades of experience from your experience at Starbucks to Kohl's to your observations about how the industry has adapted more generally. What have you taken away these last few months that can help guide all of the small businesses and in the industry, in the retail industry broadly, that are on the call tonight? What have you observed that can really help guide them as they move forward from here?
Yeah, well, David, I mean, the last few months are beyond anything we could have ever imagined in our professional and our personal life. And as all of this hit, as we think about in that early March timeframe, it just happened so quickly, and we needed to pivot and be agile in ways I think we never even could imagine or thought possible. And so I would say kind of in the first chapter of the crisis, it was all about bringing a sense of calm and clarity to the team and the organization with so much out of your control, with so much uncertainty, and frankly, a level of fear that I can't recall another time in our world where we felt that. So as a leader, you just got to calm everything down and control what you can control. And for us, we quickly established two key priorities, which is one, do everything we could to protect the safety of our people and our customers. And secondly, given that we were a non-essential retailer, we needed to protect the financial viability of the company, recognizing that at some point our stores were going to be closed, and that in fact happened. So that was sort of the first phase of that calm clarity. We ultimately did close our stores on March 20th, a date I will never forget, and they ended up being closed for 7 weeks. Put tremendous pressure, but happy to say we're on the other side. But sort of then that next phase is how do you move from defense to offense? So recognizing that 75% of our business was shut down, but we had 25% that was operating. And so how do you make the most of that? And I will tell you, since we leaned into that channel by introducing, and Gene referenced innovations, for us, it was curbside. It was changing our website to be more relevant. That business accelerated like crazy. I mean, in the month of May, as an example, it was up 90%. year on year. So trying to help offset some of the business, of course, that we lost as we've been ramping up our stores. So that sort of has been the bulk of, I would say, the middle of this crisis. And now we're looking on the other side. As of Monday, we have 90% of our stores reopened. They're reopened in a very different way. I mean, if you walk into our stores, I mean, a year ago, I couldn't have imagined seeing what I see with our associates with masks, with plexiglasses. And I think Jean referenced it. I've been amazed with the level of entrepreneurialism and agility and responsiveness to go from never having to deploy these kind of operations to standing it up within a matter of weeks. And that's all going really well. Our customers are appreciating and visited a number of stores. They're happy to be back in our stores. But now as we emerge and we're operating in this new way, I think it's an opportunity to look further into the horizon. And so kind of chapter three is, what is this new normal and what is Kohl's of the future? And not that we want to react and overreact to what's gone on the last couple months, but it really does provide a backdrop to think about this as a reset. Maybe things that we wanted to do all along, but now they're accelerating, or new customer needs that we can fulfill. So, you know, I'm looking forward to, and now we're juggling our time between managing the new realities of today, but also looking to the opportunity of the future.
Jean, similar to retail, many customers are becoming comfortable with using a takeout app or picking up their food, taking it home. How are you thinking about the future of digital and takeout businesses as a result of this pandemic? How is that accelerating trends as you think about Darden?
Well, as we went into the pandemic, off-premise business was accelerating the access to our business was being more available to people in many different areas. First, let me state that you can't have a thriving off-premise business without having a thriving on-premise business in full service. That's really important. And we can't, for those full service restaurant operators out there, you can never lose focus on that, because the off-premise business will be fleeting if you don't have that thriving in on-premise business. As far as digital goes, the way we think about digital is we're trying to remove friction from the consumer experience. And we're trying to ensure that we can get an order, make payment, give instructions on how to pick up. What has happened through this process is that's all accelerated. We're much further ahead than we were 90 days ago, and that's going to be a real asset to us as we move forward. As far as digitally on-premise, I believe that quick service operators are starting to train the consumer to order ahead. And I think that's the next big trend on premise, and that eventually most of our guests will order their food online before they come into the restaurant. I think we're 3 to 5 years away from that, but that's a trend that we're really paying close attention to. I also think it's important that I tell our folks here tonight that we do not use the third-party aggregators in our company. We believe that they're bad for our business. We believe that they have all the research that we do says it's a low satisfaction experience. There are two things that are very important in off-premise, which is on time and accurate. And the aggregators are not very good at that. And so we believe that they're a real risk to your business, that you need to find solutions without them. And you have to have a great off-premise experience so that your consumer will come and deal directly with you. And then you won't have to deal with the extra cost and the impact on your business model. So we believe, when we think about off-premise, we need to have a frictionless experience that the consumer wants to come to our place of business to pick it up.
Thank you. Michelle, I spoke to Best Buy CEO Corey Barry a few weeks ago, and she emphasized how the coronavirus was really accelerating a number of trends that were already embedded in their business, from a shift to digital curbside pickup, concierge services, you know, similar to the acceleration of trends that Jean was just talking about. What have you seen at Kohl's in terms of an acceleration of those trends? And can you talk a little bit about what you're seeing and where you think things will go?
Yeah, David. So I would speak really to four things from the acceleration of trends, and I couldn't agree with that more. I think what's happening right now are trends that we saw happening, and with COVID-19, everything has accelerated tremendously. So first, we were speaking about it earlier, but it's the role of digital. And so we're seeing that on our business. Everybody's seeing the adoption of digital. You've always had those ahead of the curve or savvy digital users, but now we're seeing a lot more people get a lot more comfortable. And you know, my hope and expectation is coming out of this that customers will be a lot more comfortable shopping in multiple ways, because those make for the best customers. And I think it's going to bring a lot more innovation. Curbside is an example. Many are doing that now, but there'll be other innovations to come. So I'd say that's first. Secondly, is I do think the relevancy of trust has gone up significantly during this time, and that will continue on. You know, I think, you know, during a time of fear and uncertainty, customers gravitate to brands and companies that they believe in. And so trust is just so critical. And you know, I think it's a privilege that I work for a company that has great trust and that we offer and sell a lot of great iconic trusted brands. I think third is the role of value, and whether it's going to be the economic consequences of what we're going through or just a return to the importance of value and maybe living a simpler life. And so what that means for all of us, I think, yet to be seen, but value is key part of our values, and we'll continue to put a key priority on that. And then lastly, I do think the role of brick and mortar, retail, restaurants, I mean, just settings where customers and people congregate is really going to change. As it relates to retail stores, clearly we've talked about heightened cleanliness and safety. And I'm not sure if we'll be wearing masks and have plexiglasses forever, but I do think the consumer will expect a higher bar as it relates to cleanliness. But I also believe the bar is raised on what experience you're creating inside that brick and mortar. As everybody gets a lot more comfortable to transact online, why are you going to go in the store? And there should be a great experience, entertainment, and discovery. And so again, I think this period has just heightened and accelerated all of those things for consumers and for businesses like us, small and large.
Yeah. Jide, your businesses are located across the country with different states reopening at different rates. How are you learning from one state to the next about what works and what doesn't? And what are your thoughts that you have for small business owners as they think about how best to reopen their businesses?
So as we're global, as noted earlier, and in some ways we've learned more from our operations abroad that has helped us as we've looked to reopen here domestically. We have a big operation in China, which was shut a month or two before we shut our stores here in North America, and then reopened a month or two earlier than here in North America. And so some of the lessons we learned there, which we're now applying here domestically, are first and foremost, listen to your employees, listen really carefully to them. And their level of concern about their health and safety. So leading by making sure you're protecting their health and safety. And then secondly, really thinking through in any given location what's going on in the broader community. So it's not just simply about we want to open up as soon as we can. We want to listen to our employees. We clearly need to make sure we understand all of the regulatory issues, which do differ not just state by state, but often community by community. So make sure that we're honoring both of those. And then what are the other stores in our that neighborhood, in that region or in that mall, what are they doing? And so we won't open until a certain critical mass of other stores around us are opening and are prepared to open. In our case, if it's, for example, in a mall, we'll wait until roughly 60-70% of the other stores in that environment are opening, because we do believe it's an ecosystem where we each help each other through that process. And also with consumers coming in, we've learned that they tend to want to have a bit of an ecosystem around them. And then we actually also very specifically have key other brands who we believe attract a consumer who is more consistent with ours, that we will look to what are they doing in and around us. So it's a combination of different factors that we look at, but first and foremost, we're led by our people. Both how do we protect their health and safety? And then secondly, what guidance are they giving us in terms of their sense as to what's going on in that community, in that ecosystem.
It looks like we're out of time for this session, but I want to start first by thanking our three CEOs. So Jide, Michelle, and Jean, thank you for joining us.